webinar is on thermal management of electric motors, and we will discuss many aspects regarding the thermal management of motors and in general motors also. So the webinar summary is like that. We will discuss about the different type of motors used in electric vehicle industry and why thermal management is important in the motors. And then we will discuss about the basics of heat transfer and how heat is transferred inside the body, and then heat generation, how heat is generated in the motor, what are the reasons for heat generation. After that, once we will discuss about heat generation, we will discuss about heat transfer paths. So what are the major heat transfer paths inside the motor from which we can take advantage as an engineer and incorporate in our design. And we will discuss about mathematical models of motor also. After that, we will discuss about simulation softwares. What are the tools used in industry, and what are the good tools to use, and which can reduce your product development time. And then we will discuss about thermal solution for motor. What are the solution available in market, and what kind of solution is used in the market people are using. And then we will discuss about companies, different company in this domain, and opportunities. So from there, we can start our webinar. And first, we'll discuss about type of electrical motors which are used in EV industry. So there are, you can see there are classification on the basis of application also, on the basis of flux also, like which kind of flux is in there. So there are main few type of motor which are used in electric vehicle industries. So the PMSM motors, VLDC motor, induction, switch reluctance, and flux switching motor. These are the major player in industry. So PMSM motors and VLDC motors, they both are almost similar. Only difference is in the winding and waveform. But PMSM motors are a bit costlier than the VLDC motors. Then come the induction motor, which is used in Model S, Tesla Model S. And these are pretty reliable motors. As compared to PMSM, PMSM motors are a bit more good in efficiency and more easy to control. Then come the switch reluctance motor. Again, same. These kind of motors don't have magnets. So these are a bit more reliable than the PMSM also, and less costlier. But the control system for switch reluctance motors is again difficult. And flux switching motors are same, fall under the category of switch reluctance motor only. They have, they don't have a permanent magnet in their rotor. So they are almost similar in structure, but little bit different in the manner the flux interact with the rotor. So again, on the basis of, just one minute. On the basis of type of application, can you give me a minute? Yeah, sorry, due to power failure. Again, on the basis of type of flux in the motor, there are two types of motor used in axial flux and radial flux motor. So radial flux are used in our normal application, two-wheeler, four-wheeler, and even in buses also. Axial flux motors are now coming, and they are more powerful. They have high power density, but the cooling system is a bit difficult for axial flux motors. And the manufacturing specs are also difficult in the axial flux motors. And on the basis of application, motors like two-wheeler, three-wheeler, they're used in electric commercial vehicles, electric buses, even electric aircraft. So one of the interesting applications which is coming is in the electric aircraft, which is using axial flux kind of motors, because they require high power density in small space. So that is the classification of motor. Now, the important question comes is why thermal management is important for a company, why they should spend money on the thermal management. So from economics point of view, it is very important. So motors are generally 10 to 15 motor and plus power electronics are 10 to 15% of the total cost of the vehicle. And if there is any failure in the vehicle or reliability issue due to the...
Lavdeep?
Yeah, hello.
Hey, so sorry to interrupt. So we can see, we can hear some background noises. Like, can you just go to somewhere like peaceful and...
is it fine now?
Sorry.
Actually, this suddenly power failure happened and that's right. So, So I was telling, I will again repeat this presentation. So why this thermal management is important from the economics point of view also. I was telling that the motors and rollers, they are a major cost role in the overall.
Your voice is breaking. Lavdeep?
Hello.
Lavdeep, your voice is breaking. So there is a voice lag and it's breaking sometimes. Can you just check your internet connection once again?
Check whether it's fine now.
Now it's clear. Yes, I think you can resume now.
Okay. So I'll resume from there only. So yeah. The main point is, it is very important to give a proper thermal management solution to the motors, because in case of failure, it's going to be cost to company also or a consumer also, and it's a huge amount of money for a company per vehicle. So it is important from economics point of view also from a company. And next question come is why motor fail? Because level of steel, copper, why motor fail? So this is the most fundamental question come. And the failure of motor is, there are 3-4 mode of failure in the motor. First is the failure of insulation. So in motor, there are A, B, and F and H type of insulation class, depend upon your application also. And these insulations are dependent upon temperature. If temperatures go beyond their limit, this insulation fails. And once this insulation fails, there is a chance of short circuit in the winding, and the short circuit from the winding to the casing of motor. And which, in the case of bus, which is a high voltage system of 600 volt and 700 volt, that voltage can pass through the bus chassis and can harmful for humans also. So it is very important to prevent these kind of failure. Then with the 8 to 10 degree rising temperature of body, life of motor get half. So from the reliability issues, from side, it is very important to have a proper thermal management system so that we can keep the temperature low and we can give a better and reliable solution to a customer. And then third is that due to high temperature, permanent magnets lose its strength. And once they lose their strength, the torque generating capability loses and the overall efficiency, motor will pull more current from the winding. And due to that, there will be high losses. Indirectly, it is coupled to efficiencies of the motor. And even motor loses its capability of giving the proper torque for a vehicle. So from considering all this point, it is very important to have a proper thermal management system for a motor. Now, before going into thermal management solution, you should be understanding why, what are the heat transfer and what is the heat generation, all those fundamental. So from this diagram, you can see that there are three modes of heat transfer, and that is conduction. Explain these modes in detail in further slides, but you can see from this diagram how the heat is transferring inside the fluid through convection and through electromagnetic waves for radiation and through the body of the handle through the conduction. So all these are the modes of heat transfer in the body. So first we'll start with the conduction heat transfer. So conduction heat transfer required a medium for transferring the heat from one point to another point. And heat transfer rate inside the body is dependent upon your type of material, I mean the conductivity of material, and then it depend upon the cross section area of the material, and then the temperature difference between the two bodies, high temperature and lower temperature body. So this is the basic mode of heat transfer. So then another heat transfer is the convection heat transfer. So in and it can be leaked. Yeah.
Again, your voice is like breaking. Can you just repeat the previous statement again?
This conduction heat transfer?
No. Hello, can you hear me? Just the previous statement alone.
Okay. Yeah. So in convection heat transfer, you require a fluid medium. It may be air, it may be water or any oil. So convection heat transfer again further divided into two categories, that is natural convection and forced convection. So first we will discuss about the natural convection. As its name indicate, it doesn't require any driving force. So the heat transfer and the fluid movement is due to gravity difference between the hot fluid and the cold fluid. So hot fluid from the body, when the cold fluid come and touch to the body, it become hot and raises up, and then it's get replaced by the cold fluid. So this is the mode of heat transfer. This is the driving power behind this heat transfer. And in this mode of heat transfer, there is something called convection coefficient, which is varies from 5 to 20 for air. This is just for air. And this is the major thing we want. We want to increase that value. And this factor is again dependent upon multiple things. It looks simple. So the heat transfer in convection, natural convection, is dependent upon area, temperature difference, which is a temperature of fluid minus temperature of body or opposite, and the H value. And H value, look, this expression look very simple, H A delta T. But this H value is dependent upon Nusselt number, and which is again dependent on Grashof and Prandtl number. So these are the function of gravity, these are the function of length of the body, these are the function of CP of air. So all those factors contribute, and in general we get a value of H between 5 and 20. So these value define the how much is the heat transfer rate. And now we will so next heat transfer mode is the forced convection. And as it is name is indicating, in the forced convection heat transfer, we required an external source of power, like fan or pump, which can drive the fluid. In this case, the heat transfer coefficient, which I was mentioning in the previous slide, so these are very high number. This comes from 30 to 300 in case of air. In case of water, these can go into thousands. Also, so these are very high number. So imagine that if you have a forced convection, a H value of 100, and in case of natural convection, you have a H value of 10. There will be 10 times more heat transfer in case of forced convection. That's why forced convection are better solution than the natural convection. But the drawback is you require external power source, and these are not reliable in case of car or some vehicle. If there is a failure in the pump or fan, your solution can fail, that the motor can fail. So considering all these things, you have to decide which kind of heat transfer mode you have to take. So this actually again depended upon Reynolds number, Prandtl number. These are the complex factor you have to calculate. These are some analytical calculation we can do on very high basis, but these are not very accurate calculations. So then the third heat transfer mode is the radiation heat transfer mode. Radiation heat transfer mode, it's dependent upon the absolute temperature of a body. If body has a high temperature, it will emit more heat to the ambient. Then another factor which define this radiation heat transfer is the surface area of the body. With the higher surface area, there will be higher heat transfer rate. And then third factor is the emissivity of body. So emissivity is the function of material. It's a function of surface finish, which kind of surface, like if same material with the polished, you can get low emissivity. And if it is rough and oxidized, you will get a high emissivity. So it's depend upon the surface of finish and surface, what kind of surface operation you have done on your material. So emissivity is defined by that. In the radiation heat transfer, you don't require any medium. Like radiation from sun to earth is reaching through vacuum. There is no requirement of any medium. And the radiation heat transfer is used mostly in space applications because there are no fluids in the space. So for satellite cooling and other application, mostly radiation heat transfer is very dominant. Next, we will discuss about heat generation in the motor. Heat is generating in the motor. And there are many factors, like there are core losses, ohmic losses, friction, windage, and other factors also, minor factors. But majorly, core and ohmic losses play a role. So the when before calculating the heat generation in the motor or understanding, we should be understanding type of application and the load condition on motor. If there is a certain kind of load and there is a constant torque load, what kind of application is there? From there, we can predict that what kind of heat load are generated in the motor. So there are major two classification. So one is the core losses, another is the ohmic losses in the motor. Core losses are combination of hysteresis losses and eddy current losses. And these are difficult to calculate, even though they have formula. I have mentioned in the corner of the slide, they have the formula, but these factors are very difficult to predict. So that's why we usually depend upon the curve given by the manufacturer. So these losses are given by manufacturer from where we are buying the steel. Another losses are the ohmic losses, which is the heat generation due to when current pass through the conductor. So these are dependent on the resistance of the conductor inside the motor. So if we choose a thin wire, there will be high resistance in the wire. And if we choose thick wire, there will be less resistance. But it has its own implication on the electromagnetic design side of the motor. So from there, we can calculate the ohmic losses. Then there are friction losses in the bearing and minor windage losses due to aerodynamic drag. But these are difficult to calculate and even negligible for our own study. So we usually neglect these kind of losses. One more thing, in the core losses, hysteresis and eddy current losses. So to avoid eddy current losses, motors are always built with the lamination stacks of the material, steel material, and their thickness is very less, like 0.35 mm. So we try to reduce the thickness of those stacks so that we can reduce the eddy current losses. That's why motors are not always solid block. They are made of stacks to reduce this eddy current losses in the motor. Heat transfer path. This is very important thing to understand how the heat is transferring from source to the sink or ambient. So for our case, it may be ambient is our sink. In some high power motors, the radiator may be our sink. So all it's depend. So here you can see I have created very simple resistance network diagram just to give understanding how the heat is. There will be multiple diagram of these kinds, but only I have created only one. So from the stator, which is the heat source, and stator, there are two heat sources. One is stator steel, which is a lamination steel, and it is generating heat due to hysteresis and eddy current. And then the another losses are core losses, copper losses, which is due to I square R. These losses first transfer to the casing through the, there will be a resistance between casing and stator, which is called contact resistance. And this resistance is dependent upon your type of fitting of the motor. If you have done the press fit, which is usually the case, press fit between stator and the casing. So then there will be very less resistance. If these are a bit loose fit, then there will be high resistance. People use thermal interface material to reduce these kind of resistance. Then from casing to ambient, there is called casing to ambient resistance. And this is this again depend upon H value. And H value is a complex factor, which is again dependent upon multiple factor like geometry, fluid velocity, type of fluid temperature, and all those factors. and then you can see the casing thermal resistance. So casing is usually made of cast iron, which has its own resistance to the heat transfer. So all these things added on and give the overall resistance to the stator to MA. These kind of models are very helpful for an engineer to understand what will be the, if you know the ambient temperature and if you know, if you have a high level idea of H value, you can predict that the stator is going to be what temperature. So for initial calculation and for initial understanding of the model, these kind of models are required. Then mathematical model, as I explained earlier. So this is the same thing. Mathematical model of include all the thermal resistance networks which are inside the motor, from whether it's minor heat transfer path or major heat transfer path. And this basically give the understanding about the heat transfer inside the motor and give insight what will be the solution we can use for our motor. So these are usually 1D model, and we assume that heat is transferring in one direction. So these are very simplified model with the accuracy of 50% to 60%. They give us the right direction whether to choose liquid cooling or air cooling or what kind of solution we can choose. And these are very important. Even simulation tools are there and they can model our whole motor. But these are important for understanding how actual heat is transferring as a designer. So before doing any simulation or tool, understanding of this mathematical model is very important and it's required. So then we will discuss about the software which are used in modeling. There are many thermal software, like plenty of thermal software available in the market, and it can be used. I mean, any software can be used for this kind of application, but there are particular softwares also and in this kind of industry standard which are used in the industry. So thermal software like ANSYS Fluent with the combined heat transfer is used. Star CCM Plus is used for heat transfer. MotorCAD, which is a particularly focused on motor design, and they have their own module which is a based on thermal resistance network, and JMAG has their own capability of heat transfer. And then the electromagnetic analysis, the ANSYS Maxwell is there. MotorCAD, again MotorCAD has their electromagnetic analysis software also. JMAG is there. JMAG is for electromagnetic simulation and heat generation. FEMI is an open source software used for electromagnetic simulation. And then Altair Flux is there, Opera is there. There are many tools available in the market, but again, it's depend upon your application and how much time you want to spend and cost also. So better solution is a kind of couple software in which you have a thermal capabilities and electromagnetic capabilities coupled together. It will reduce a lot of time in your modeling and it will reduce a lot of product development time. So ANSYS Fluent is one of the such application where you can do them in Maxwell. You can design the electromagnetic of the motor and then you can couple with the Fluent. And from Fluent, you can directly get the heat transfer and temperature of the bodies. MotorCAD also provide that kind of integrated environment for thermal and electromagnetic capabilities. But again, it depends upon designer, how he want to design, and again, application of the what kind of motor you are designing. So then come the thermal solution. Now we have already discussed about heat generation in the motor. We have discussed what are the path in the motor, and we have discussed how to do this what are the software for doing the thermal analysis. The major thing is what are the solution engineer is giving to the company. So there are multiple solution for same application. So there are passive solution also, active solution also. I have mentioned a few. So in passive solution are the solution in which you don't require any external power source, and they are naturally driven. So like natural convection, which is for very low power motors, and then there are coating material. So coating materials are used for increasing the overall thermal conductivity of the end winding and even winding. So in winding there are air pockets always. Air has a very low thermal conductivity. So what we do is we usually put the coating material in between. So what it did, it replaced the air from those air pockets, and we fill the potting material there, and potting material has a good thermal conductivity. So overall thermal conductivity, and you can say the resistance of the binding decreases a lot. So these are very important. And then we use some application use heat pipes. Heat pipes are not used in automotive application. These are very rare, and these are very costly solution also. These are used in our computer CPU for getting the heat from the processor to the near to the fan. And then we have active solution, which required external power solution, power source. So in that come the forced air convection. So these are for mid level of motor, from 3 to 10 kilowatt power of motor. Again, this depend upon application. If we have a motor with the open ambient, maybe you can use a natural convection, but if it is very constrained and there is a very less access to air and airflow paths are not proper, then you maybe you have to go for liquid cooling. So it totally depend upon the application, but these kind of things give the high level of idea which kind of application, which kind of solution we can use. Then the liquid cooling jacket, which is for more than 10 kilowatt, and this is used in like in heavy vehicles. Like liquid cooling is the standard thing which is used in the motors. Then liquid cooling for rotor, which is used by Tesla in their motor Model S, and for induction motor and for cooling. And then jet spray, which is the cooling down of winding. Other than that, there are other solutions also, like motors are filled with oil to cool down. So those are a bit unconventional solutions. So these are the major solutions used in the industry. So after that, we will tell you what are the major company in this domain, so which are working on particular electric motors or cooling system. So there are many, many companies in electric motor, but I have mentioned a few and very famous, and which are working on the cutting edge technology in the electric motor. So Siemens is working on electric motors. They are developing for EVs also. They are developing for electric aircraft also. They already developed one aircraft for motors for aircraft. And these are pretty good and pretty cutting edge solution they are developing. Yasa Motor is a company which came out from Oxford University, and they are also working on axial flux motors for high power density motors. And these are for like aircraft and heavy vehicles. Then Magnes is also working on the axial flux motors for aircraft and electric heavy vehicle, electric vehicle. And Avi Technology is working on cooling system of motors, batteries, and power electronics. They are providing solution, thermal interface materials, and other kind of solution to for thermal management. And then Protean is also working on motors, developing the axle motor, axle kind of motor in hub motors for the heavy vehicles. And they are also like on the cutting edge technology in the electric vehicle. So I mentioned a few. These are very top player in the motors. Opportunity in this domain, what kind of opportunities people will get in this domain and work on motor and thermal management. So the first is the design engineer. So these opportunities and whatever name I mentioned, it again depend from company to company. In startup, maybe you have different nomenclature. In big company, maybe different. So design engineer who is like looking for the whole requirement to the end of the design. He's looking at the overall thing. And the project requirement generation, which is very important for companies to understand the requirement from customer and converting those requirement into the engineering requirement. Usually customer, they don't have a particularly engineering requirement. They have their application requirement. So the design project requirement generation engineer understand their application and then convert it into the design or engineering requirement. So simulation engineers are there who do the simulation. After getting the requirement from the requirement engineer, they do the simulation for motor. And then the manufacturer engineering, they look into the manufacturing. Even for thermal manufacturing, sometimes very difficult, manufacturing the heat pipe, you can say, or liquid cooling jacket, which can be very costly. So understanding all those things is very important. Then testing engineer who test whether the whatever simulation or whatever we analytical model we have done, whether those are right or wrong. So these are the testing engineer, but they all required some level of understanding of thermal management and some level of understanding of motors design. Then the skill required, what are the skill required in this domain? So under first thing is you required understanding of heat generation in the motor. This is very important. Different motors have a different heat generation source. Like I already mentioned, a flux switching motor, they have DC winding also, AC winding also. So they both add heat into the heat generation. So if you understand the heat generation, then later on you can try to reduce it also by telling the electromagnetic engineer to do some manipulation or design iteration for reducing the heat losses. And then another thing required is modeling and simulation tools. These are very important. Analytical calculation to some extent will give you some result. They will give you result up to 50%. But with the simulation tool, you have, it is very important because you will get result of 80-90% accurate. Usually these are not very accurate with the flow and convection. These are not very accurate. They go up to 70%, but which is still a good number for us. Then understanding of heat transfer path is very important in the motor, because without those understanding, you will not able to provide a solution. Like what kind of solution we can give into motor, like giving the high, you can say oxidized surface on the motor, if you want to increase the radiation heat transfer path inside the motor. In the motors, rotor have a very less conduction path, because rotors are rotating, there is a very less conduction from rotor to casing. So in that case, radiation play a major role. So with the high oxidized surface, you can increase the heat transfer path. So understanding the heat transfer path is very important. And then the calculations and decision making on the basis of those. So after understanding all those things, you have to make a decision what philosophy we should choose, whether to go with liquid cooling or whether to go with the natural convection. These are very important, because in the long term your product should not fail. So understanding and then taking proper decision making is very important, and this is a kind of skill which with the more problem solving will come.